So this site here still sits with the Minister for Planning, so we're still responsible for maintaining it. And I wasn't, just a disclaimer, I wasn't involved in doing the seeding and stuff. I've only been managing it for the last couple of years because I was working out south before. But these two characters have done a lot of the work. you can blame them for all these weeds. So, to give you some context, here's a map of the site. So this one I've just
That's
put on.
That's why I came to hold those.
So the shaded areas are the site. So it goes across the other side of Main North Road as well, and it straddles two council areas. So it's Town of Gawler and City of Playford, and it makes up part of the green belt between those two councils.
I think it's like 200 hectares, isn't it,
Jen? Yeah, it's a total land of 250 hectares, and of that, 230 have had active restoration on them. It was originally grazing land. Used to be a shearing shed right there that we just knocked down recently. And the sheep were progressively taken off the land, and the restoration started over on the other side. Oh, it started in this L-shaped block that you drove past up here, which now actually is part of Town of Gawler. And that was just with tube stock planting. And then across the road, in this one here, there was a huge amount of tube stock planted in there. And then in 2009, and then up there, you can see the trees up there, the more old school re-veg, just tube stock planting. And people started getting involved with the direct seeding in 09, which is what I've got these years on the map there for. So that was all you, Tim, I guess, doing all the direct
actually
seeding.
The original section over the other side of the road there, Glenn did some direct seeding in between the rows of trees that were planted originally, some pinnipod seeding, and that was enough for Ubu to sort of commit to, successful enough that Ubu wanted to commit to doing a larger scale rollout of, you know, it was mostly pinnipods with some daisies, I think mainly a bit of dinia and a few other species, probably about seven or eight species, wasn't it?
The vitidinias are actually looking really good now. Yeah, they're taking off around the edges and self-seeding. So, yeah, that area, the structures actually, it was criticised a fair bit at the time for being too dense and full of rigodia and that type of thing. But the structure's really settled itself out now, and the trees have started coming up, and it all sort of makes a lot more sense of a nice sort of porosa woodland over kinopod understory. So that's looking pretty good. So in terms of the grasses, it was in 2010 that Tim did a bit of an experimental strip, which is up that way. Yeah, I don't really have a good map of it. Yeah, that's one of the results. Is that you harvesting? I don't know who it was. I just found the photo. Yeah? So that's the grass grabber that Tim was talking about before. So, do you want to talk about that?
Oh, I spoke about it a bit yesterday. This little brush harvest has been around for, you know, best part of three decades. But as I said, there's a guy called Paul Ursi in New South Wales who's just come up with a little lightweight one. It can either operate on the front of a ATV or just hand pushed, and it's just a really good machine for money. I know Project Andrew's been working with. They've got a couple of them, and you guys have got one, probably, you know, several in the state. So the big toad ones and things are great, but they're just expensive and you're not going to be quite awkward to set up and work with, whereas these you just pull them off the trailer and off you go. So small sites, I mean, obviously a big site like this that was up there, a big mechanised one behind a car and stuff would work really well, but a lot of the time in South Australia we've only got small remnants on road sites and things like that. So a small machine just gives you a lot of flexibility to move around, and I've used one of these out in the rangeland so I can get in around trees and things like that if we've got grasses on the trees and things. Lazy.
So how much of the plant ripped off, and how does that happen?
Not too much. You get a little bit of stalk in there, but not too much grown. It's a bit of stalk in there. And I mean, that's not certainly not clean enough if we're going to do. Sell it to just everyone, but just collecting for this project. So generally I just put all of my grasses through a mulcher, because we're just hand broadcasting now, put it through a mulcher. This goes for the stipers as well, and just mix it with the vermiculite, medium grade vermiculite, just to make it a bit easier to to hand broadcast and bulk it up a bit, and off we go into prepared sight, and it seems to work. Keep it simple, you know. Fair enough if you're trying to do 100 hectares, but we're just not. We all want to get there, but we're not doing that yet. So, and that's why we still need mechanisation, obviously, seeding and things like that. But as I said yesterday, you just get lost in that. And at the end of the day, I just want to get out and do some re-veg. That's what I want to do, and get some outcomes. And you get lost in workshops, doing stuff. And you know, that's great. John's done some amazing things. That's a lot of inspiration, all the stuff he's done. But I did a lot of tinkering in my workshop and mucking around with sea boxes and things, and I'm better off being out in the field getting on with some stuff. So
talking about tinkering, well, you got that excellent photograph there, is that my machine, which is a reel over brush, is the Henske's, also had one that you showed yesterday, and I've modified mine now, because what those brushes do, because you're going straight into the columns in front of it, they'll grab those columns and rip it out and give you what Jody had yesterday, all that bucket full of straw as well as a bit of seed. In my case, with a reel over the top, I've just got a shield in front of the brush, but the brush is only a small diameter, and the reel brings the heads of the grass over to the top of the brush, so it's only the seed that gets ripped out. It doesn't touch the columns, and I don't need to do any seed cleaning, as you say, hardly. We'll just take a pure sample of seed. And I've had problems with, not tons, but kilos and kilos of dirty seed to clean. Reaction to a grass seed. It wasn't a good combination, so I just couldn't even clean it. But, bad enough job any time, you know, getting an allergy to it. So I've got away from that just by modifying the harvesting machine, not the seed, only the seed clearer.
Yeah, it takes a part of the process out then, doesn't it?
It does, yeah. So,
but just back to site preparation, I saw a presentation that Ian Chivers did a few years ago, and I think you found that site preparation, it doesn't matter what machinery you use, particularly as long as you've got a prepared surface to go into. Though we did find that when I was selecting a machine myself, I did start looking at the one that Paul Gibson Roy uses, which the Grassy Ground Cover Project has. But in the end, I ended up buying this machine, which is a bit odd looking, 3-point linkage machine. It's a power landscape rake, and Econodynamics has this machine now. And it actually is a turf preparation machine for sports fields and things like that, so it'll go out and it'll level out a site, and it leaves both large and small dirt particles, so you've still got it's not turning it into powder like a rotary hoe wheel. So what we've got to do is level the site, so we've got a nice seedbed to put into, like that. These are great photos, but
that's kind
of okay.
That's the pinafore.
Is that distributed?
So that's the grass I was doing there.
Okay.
That's the pinafore.
Well, it just gives you an idea. It's the same machine that's used for the same thing, so it's a nice, even surface prepared. And then just set the machine up really carefully to just tickle that seed into the surface too. And not only, that's the other thing with hand seeding, obviously, as you're broadcasting it out, it's not evenly spread like it would with a mechanical machine. But then that machine in particular, because it's still raking the surface as it goes along, helps to evenly spread the seed out across the surface, and it also just gets that seed soil contact, which is, as we've been discussing, has been quite critical in getting a higher success rate. So,
in terms of facts about the grass seeded areas in here, so the original area that these guys did was 2 hectares. And that was done with, was for the 2 hectares, it was about 36 kilos of seed. And it was pelletised, so you had it sent off to Victoria or something.
So it was quite seeds in Queensland, in Queensland.
It was a pretty expensive way, though, to have it done compared to this section here, which is about 7 hectares of seeding. And the seed was collected from there, that seed in the photo, the grass grabber. And then it was just a cost of running a daily rate of running that across, which made this site, even though it's much larger, much more cost effective. And that's that site that we may or may not get up to see in spring 2013. And these photos, to prove there is actually native grass in here, you just have to walk in a bit. We've had it slashed as a bit of a time slash, which ended up being a bit later than we thought, because of the rain. And that's the sort of results. And this is some incidental site prep that Tim did. You can see on this map the burn scar that from a fire started with a slashing deck in November of the year before it was seeded. And the best results are up there in that area. Okay, we can't take credit then.
And that was the interesting thing, as I was doing the site preparation out here, where it had been burnt, the amount of ryegrass, because as you see there's annual ryegrass here, that it would have been 10% of what it was in the unburnt areas. And as we're seeding, I just said to the person who was working with me, I said, I'll guarantee this will be a better result in the burnt section. Be interesting, I never got back to have a look at it, but and you know what Jen's saying is supports that. So it just goes to show fire is such a great tool, and it's a pity that more fire hadn't been implemented on this site as a site preparation tool to get rid of not just the biomass on site, but to get rid of the seed bank, the weed seeds. You know, it's obviously fire is going to kill a lot of the, not all, but a lot of the weed seed bank.
So we did use fire in sites we've worked on at Maslin's and at Craigman Farm. So they're pretty large scale areas. There's one picture there of, it's a picture of the burnt area. And so they were burnt, knocked down, burnt and scraped, but there's still weeds. There's less, but
Have you got any plans to burn again, to reinvigorate the place and get seed production going again?
Yeah, so we've been, as maintenance, we've just been slashing. The results, we didn't really see much going on for even the first 3 years, and so we were just slashing it. And then in 2015 it started looking good, so we're like, excellent. Something's actually happened and it's coming up nicely. And so we've just been talking recently about doing some patch burning and trying to get some diversity in there, because we've now planted in the roads. We've got a 20 million trees project to work in here and get some overstory in. So we've done sort of 30 metre spaced ukes and some calatris and she oaks and those types of things, and also some acacias.
I guess if you were to do patch burning, you could do it scientifically, and you could have control plots and things like that to measure it. To
see exactly.
Yeah,
we were thinking about burning some and putting some thermometer in, doing some just as control, and seeing how it responds.
If you want to minimise your fire, just cut it with a hay mower or whatever, let the hay dry and then burn that. That's a much cooler fire.
Oh yeah.
Makes a heck of a lot of smoke, your neighbours might like it.
So yeah, I'm just going to pick up on that. Where we're standing is just really to talk to you. Came out here on Tuesday night. Going to walk down to row 5, walk about 500 metres in, and that fire scar that Tim showed you will walk to that edge, and it is day and night. The difference is really quite stunning.
When was the fire?
2012. What? And in November.
Sorry?
November 2012. And also, just because we didn't really state this earlier, the design of this site was in stripes, so it's a stripe of grass seeding and then a grass of quinopod and dicot seeding. So the idea being that it'll all mix together. And I guess interesting issues with that have been, or will be in the future probably, the fact that you get that bit of weedy grass incursion into the quinopod areas that can then spread into the grass. But up until then it's been pretty easy to manage, because you can do a grass selective on the dicot rows and a broadacre, broadleaf selective on the grass. So
how are you going to manage the weeds?
How are we going to manage
them? Salvation Jane is a weed you don't want. How are you going to manage that?
Well, until this year.
Now that you've got the trees in there.
Yeah, well, until this year we've been able to do
But you've still got the weed. Now you've got the trees as well.
Well, the idea now, I think, is just going to be to wait till the trees and the larger stuff grows up and it'll outcompete it.
Oh, so you've got 5 years or 8 years before you can do that.
We can still spray the broadleaf in the grass areas, though. But,
But this site, as Jen said, it's 250 hectares, and these are nice big paddocks, big machinery, those big scoops that I put up yesterday, 14 cubic metre ones. Could have scalped this, and with all the seed that we put on, I wonder what the result would have been, because this soil's it's got a deep enough profile that you could have scalped all the nutrient stuff off, because these are all farming paddocks, so they're chock-block full of fertiliser and a huge weed load.
You're doing an experimental scout, just scout one strip, how you did and just see what the result was.
Well, that'd be great if the project was still running full steam, but it's not. So, we learn all these things. This is a great project to work on, I was saying to Jen yesterday, it was great to be involved in this the Women in Trees project because it gave us a lot of opportunity to try some different things. So rather than a revegetation project that's, you know, 1, 2, 3 years, this was 10 years, and we so we made a lot of mistakes, but it gave us rise to a lot of opportunity to try a few things. And I'm not saying we got it right, but we learned a lot from that, you know. Not just Glenn, myself and the other contractors, but the industry in a greater sense. I know Sean Kennedy's not here, is he?
He's back there.
You know, Sean and I were talking about how to get rid of wild oats out there because there was some really good remnant grassland through here as well. And I just did a lot of time looking up herbicides, and this herbicide's no longer available. I think Sean's found a replacement called Madavan 90, which is just an oats selective herbicide. And I said to the Uber guys, can I have a crack at it? I'll go and buy the tin of the herbicide. And we started using that, and it would just take out the wild oats. So we were just left. So there wasn't that imperative to send the slashes in at the time when all our native grasses were seeding. And I know that Sean took that up, and he's been using, you know, the herbicides like that over some of his sites. So
didn't take long for it to come back, though.
Oh, no, it's come back now, so. Allegedly. What's that, Sean? Right, you got a new one, have you?
Just to go back to your thoughts there on scalping the site.
Yeah.
I mean, if you've got 100 hectares, and every hectare we're going to have, if we go down 5 centimetres, we've got about 600 tonne of soil.
Yes.
So it's getting pretty silly, isn't it? To do it on this sort of scale.
At Craigburn, we did it across about 15 hectares all up, and put the soil in windrows. So we just had a contractor come in who had a grader and did these big rows, and then we had the windrows of soil, and then as management, we would just been knocking them down, and then broadleaf, broadacre spraying in the grass seeded areas. So, and now it's getting less that you have to spray them, and we've planted trees scattered on the mounds, and they do subside quite a lot.
I agree, Chris, and it is silly. And the first time I ever met Paul Gibson Roy, when Shauna Potter dragged him across when he was just starting off this project 10 years ago or whatever it was, and I went, you know, that's a lot of money, and it's a lot of diesel, and it's a lot of, you know, but I'm. Look at this, like, it's just, this isn't a great outcome. It's, we've got some great good things happening in here, but it's not a great outcome either. Mm. Or the guy that used to own it lives in that house here, and or had the, you know, the use of it, and he goes, oh, what a waste of land, it's just full of weeds now. Mm. You know, so where's the outcome? At least the community looks up that the hill there and goes, oh, those Breedlidge people did a great job up there, there's some trees. Yeah. Mm. But it's not a good grassy woodland. Mm. Mm. You know, the trees are probably planted at too high a density, and it's certainly down over there. It's just a duoculture of Eucalyptus parosa and Rigodia now. So it's not, you know, it's not a bad outcome, but it's just revegetation. It's not restoration. How many projects could people say in Australia that actually achieved a proper restoration outcome? You know, Paul Gibson Roy is one of the people who could put his hands up for it. I know Chris Bonnet has done some jobs where he'd say yeah, but a lot of it's just been big lots of grass. That's a good question to anyone. You know, where's there he is, Jeff. You know.
Well, I mean, I think it highlights a bit of a risk actually. That if you aim for restoration and you maybe overplan things a little bit, you can actually come unstuck. Like, I think sometimes it might be better to risk of this sort of happening, and then maybe adjust the expectations really early on, and then plan for that. Mm. And then, you know, for example, if say you'd use some legumes in here at a higher rate that suppress the grass a bit more, but then you might, your next man can come in and then start to knock those out, and then maybe try to get some of the grasses established.
Well, we use kinopods in here extensively, and they did a really good job, and it gave us the opportunity to select out these grasses. But it's a succession thing; those things drop out of the system, like some of the kinopods, you know, annuals, so they're only there for a couple of seasons, and then other ones like Inkmound and Tomatose will be there for sort of 5 or 6 years, and then they drop out, and nothing. It just hasn't.
Yeah.
We haven't had that succession to carry the site.
I think one of the big issues is that if you. I think we're still kind of learning, but understanding some of the agricultural type risks associated with restoration. I think restoration can come, you can end up with a worse result than we have with just the tree and
traditional re-veg.
Traditional re-veg sort of approach. So I think there's something in between. I think that's useful.
Do you think you could have overcome some of the problems that you talked about succession, things like that, by using a bigger variety of seeds in your initial mix, so you got more biodiversity, so that succession seed base is actually in the soil bank, so as some of the things that you talk about that have dropped out and aren't there anymore, and the weeds come back, other things succeeding after that in a natural sort of way? Do you think using a wider variety of seeds in your seed mix would have maybe helped that?
Or? Oh, sure, and the more species you have, the more niches you fill, but a lot of the plants, the extra diversity, you're talking about a lot of the little daisies and things like that, and just procuring a large amount of seed from there. You only have to talk to Andrew about that, trying to get large quantities of seed. We just been waiting for the species that we could get lots of seed for, you know, in a seed production area, because seed production was a pretty new thing then too. All the wheat, it was my first time with building these weed mat seed orchards and things like that, and it's just, you know, what species work, what don't. You know, some of the initial Uber ones, was full of Atroplex palliodosa. And, you know, three quarters of the plants were, no one had thought about it, but three quarters of the plants were male plants. So where's your seed production out of that? There's none. It's just been a learning, it's a big learning process. And that's what we're still at. You know, we're still learning things. And I think we, as an industry, we're doing things a lot better. But, you know, I think Jeff's hit the nail on the head. It's risk management and people's expectation. Most of my career I've done mine rehabilitation in the arid lands, and you've got people running around expecting a restoration outcome in a very limited environment for both water and nutrient, and you know, extreme temperatures and everything from frost through to 48 degrees, and we're just not getting that. Like I feel that, you know, most of the arid land mining work that I've done, if we can restart the ecological processes out there and get the fauna interacting with it and get a stable plant cover that's sustainable, well, that we've achieved 90% of what we're going to achieve. It might take 100 years, 500 years, or 1,000 years for that to get back to a landscape. Everything has to be done in human terms. Everything has to be done within a, you know, project time scale of, you know, 3 years or 5 years or whatever. And look where that's getting us as an industry. I'm not disillusioned by it, but it's been a big, 20 years ago, coming out of uni, all starry-eyed and going, oh, wow, we're going to change the world. And just, you know, I think there's a lot of positives, but you've got to be a bit realistic about it. And what Jeff's saying is, risk management, do a plan, proper plan, you know, just, yeah.
There was a plan for him.
I know, there was a plan, but it was a rolling plan. It didn't, you know, we came in with best practice, and that wasn't good enough, because it was just the traditional tube stock planning.
Cause
it was,
Yeah,
but it was experimental. Glenn said, yeah, I'll have a crack at it and see how it works out. No one really knew what Glenn had proposed. It's going to turn out. So.
After he did that, that was the plan.
Oh, sure.
Hey, honestly, we might have the deadline.
Absolutely. And this site might be great in 50 years' time when the trees and stuff get going, but it comes back to this expectations. What does the community expect in the meantime? They just sort of listen and go, it's a weedy paddock, or and the people funding it. Well, you haven't planted seeds of canopy trees. Who cares about all these grasses? That doesn't mean anything to all my constituents.
There's no koalas here. Could you overcome that community ignorance, for a better word, with education? Put a big sign up there saying, this is it now, but in 50 years' time, it's going to be native time to establish and educate them, so they're not whinging to the council all the time about this, and they actually know what processes are going on. I think that's probably a part of it.
Oh, absolutely, and I think people like Bob Myers have done such a great job in promoting grasses in South Australia, getting people to even know what it's all about, you know, and how important grassland systems and grassy woodland systems are in this state. You know, this idea that it was all, you know, wall-to-wall forest, which is not the case in South Australia. It just, you know, from what I understand, that's not the case. Whereas Bob is He's gone for a walk.
Should we go for a walk?
Let's go
this way, folks. Yeah. You're
talking about your long-term restoration.
Yeah.
If you had family to him for about 5 years, that will actually encourage regeneration.